Welcome back to the podcast. Before we get things started, I just want to tell you guys how excited I am to finally have a date for the reopening of Disneyland. I know there's a lot of crazy stuff going on in the world right now, but this is just something that means the world to me. Somewhere that I spend a whole lot of time at, and to not have been able to go there for the past couple of months has been really strange. Because when I think of Disneyland, that's my happy place. I remember my early years in Orange County, I totaled my car and I was like, you know what, fuck this. Life's pretty annoying right now. I need to find a new car, but the only thing I want to do right now is just get me to Disneyland. Let me just try not to be too bummed out about this whole car situation. So I went there and just instantly was like, you know what, I'm not dead. I probably should have died in that wreck, but I didn't. So I just had to refocus and just appreciate the fact that something so tragic could happen in my life, but within 10, 20 minutes, I could just, you know, head down the road, go to the happiest place on earth, which is Disneyland. And I'm just so happy that July 17th, Disneyland's back. And I know that may sound privileged to a lot of people, but this is just something that means the world to me. And I have invested a lot of my life being there, and I'm just really happy to get back. I'm just so excited. And people who listen to this podcast know that it means a lot to me. And thank you to everybody who sent me links and articles to read about the news that got announced today. I'm really excited and I can't wait to go back. I hope to see all of you there. Let's ride something. But on today's episode, we travel back up north, that RBS, real bay shit. I've been talking to Elliot behind the scenes for a really long time, and we were finally able to get him on the podcast, which I was super stoked about. Huge fan of Gulch. I appreciate everything they're doing for their scene up north. I was able to catch them at FYA, which was super awesome, and still a trip to me that FYA is the only fest to happen this year. Obviously, there's a reason for that, the whole pandemic situation. But I really hope that things turn around and there could be another fest that happens and just kind of get the ball rolling again for hardcore. And I know this is hardcore announced their dates in August, so I'm looking forward to see what they have lined up, see how they're going to pull this whole thing off. I'm really interested and curious to see, because we're all dying to get back to shows. It's been strange for us to not be able to go, but I'm still stoked that we're still keeping the community going. Bands are still putting out new music. Everybody's doing their best to promote and share and just, you know, keep the word of hardcore alive. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how that pans out. This year, Gulch will be releasing a new record, which Ellie and I kind of dive into, and he shared way more than I thought he would, which had me pretty stoked because I'm just so curious about what the new record's going to sound like. It's called Impenetrable Cerebral Fortress, which was leaked on Twitter. If you follow one of their guitar players, he was auctioning off Test Press, which I thought was really awesome. And he just dropped the name of the record, which had me buzzing. I was just so curious, like, okay, that's the name of the new record. I want to know more. So Elliot shared what he could, which I thought was awesome. And it was a really fun conversation. He went into the history of Gulch, learned a lot about the band. And I'm really stoked to see where they go in the future. They're going to release that new LP that I just mentioned, and I'm really looking forward to hearing it. So I hope you guys strap in and enjoy this podcast. So without further ado, please welcome Elliot to the podcast. And we're live. Welcome to the podcast, Elliot.
What's going on?
Dude, this is so awesome. I'm a huge fan of Gulch. You know what's crazy is I think about the last time I saw you guys was at FYA.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, which I'm like trying to think. Yeah, I'm trying to think. Like, did you guys not play in Southern California? Like after that, my memory's so bad when it comes to me remembering shows.
I think we played in SoCal after. It was like a week or two after. I can't remember. Because I know when things in a row, and one of them was LA. It might have been after FYA.
Okay. All right. Well, let's jump back to the very beginning. You guys put out Demolition of Human Construct in 2017. Way back then, can you talk about where the idea of Gulch came from and how you guys decided to start the band?
Yeah, so me and my boy Cole, who I've been in like almost every band with, we moved together to Scotts Valley with like his wife and a roommate of his. And we kind of just ended an old band and wanted to keep doing something new, but like really low key. So we were like, all right, let's just start something, play maybe a few shows local, drop some music. And, you know, because we were both busy, super busy at the time, and ended up meeting Sammy and Tim from Drain, because Scotts Valley is like right outside of Santa Cruz. And we just kind of met them, decided, yeah, let's fucking jam. And yeah, next thing we knew, it was like, all right, put out a demo and see what happens. But I mean, we weren't expecting much at all, honestly.
Okay. And when you guys put out that you know, first release, were you guys like pretty active as a band, or did it just kind of, you know, do things here and there?
I mean, we played like, I don't think we played a show until after we put it out. So we played a show and we didn't really practice much. We just kind of like Colin and Sammy, the drummer, practiced a few times together, wrote most of the stuff, and it was kind of just really low key. So, I mean, after that first show, I mean, we played a few others, but it wasn't like we had plans to like tour or do anything crazy off of it. Just did tapes ourselves and fucking went from there.
At that point, in your guys' scene up there, were kids pretty perceptive of Gulch when you guys first came out, or did it take a while for kids to catch on?
It took a second. I mean, it's not like we had like really bad shows where, you know, it's like you first start a band, there's like, you know, nobody really watches or whatever. I mean, we were kind of lucky because we've all been in bands for a while, like in the scene. So people like already knew us, and we were like, we had friends in the scene. So it wasn't like we had to start from the bottom like most bands do, like we've done before. So, I mean, we had good reactions and stuff. I guess like people did kind of jump onto the demo pretty hard, and I was kind of surprised by that, honestly.
So the demo came out in 2017, and it was like early 2017, and then your next release, Burning Desire to Draw Last Breath, in between those two records, when did you guys decide you wanted to release something again? Because there's only a year gap, and I feel like that's like you know, pretty active for a band to, you know, have a new release like the following year. So when did you guys realize like, okay, cool, the demo hit, kids are digging this, we're playing some cool shows, let's start writing a new record? Or was that already in the process?
I think just because we had like some momentum going from the demo, and we were like getting hit up for all these random shows, we were like, all right, maybe we should just kind of like hop on and start writing some new stuff. And Cole was already kind of like in that mode where he was just writing riff after riff just because. So I think it was just kind of like it just naturally happened. He was already kind of on the path of like writing more stuff, and we kind of were all still on where it was going. So we're like, all right, fuck it. Like we'll do a new release. We'll just, you know, I guess see who we'll put it out. And we ended up hitting the homie from Creator Destructor in Oakland like almost immediately after we wrote all the songs, because he put out some previous stuff of ours with like a Spinebreaker. And so he was like, yeah, man, I'll put this out like for sure. And we were like, okay, like that, we'll for sure do this record then. You know, we have someone who's putting it out, we don't got to come out of pocket for it. And then, yeah, so it really was only a year, I guess. I felt like maybe it was longer, but damn, I don't know. I'm not good at keeping track with that kind of shit, but I just know kind of just kept moving along. There wasn't like a big pause or anything.
Yeah, based off of Bandcamp, it says you guys released Demolition of Human Construct January 2017, and then Burning Desire to Draw Last Breath came out May 2018.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Damn. Yeah, I guess we just kept the ball rolling. I mean, Cole is good at just pumping out riffs, so all I have to do is write vocals last minute, which is always my problem, but we get it done somehow.
And is there any way you can explain the artwork for the record? Because I find it pretty interesting, and the person sitting at the table, I noticed that mask is reoccurring.
Yeah, so I don't even know how we found this artist. His name is Boone. He lives in Canada. He's a tattoo artist as well. Someone must have came across his art on like Instagram. I think it was either Cole or Christian, and we were sending it back to each other and like, dude, like, this shit's crazy, like, you know, what do you think if we use this for art? Because Cole did the layout for the demo, and we usually just, you know, do everything ourselves, but I don't know, something about the art we just really liked. We hit up the guy and he was down for it, and told him kind of like, these are the song titles, you know, if you want to work off that for the record. And that's what he came up with, and we're like super stoked on it. I don't know, I haven't seen stuff like that in a long time, and his art's really original, so I felt it just worked for what we were trying to do, which was not fall into typical, you know, like stereotypical hardcore look, you know, not necessarily super on purpose, but I mean, there's so many bands that just kind of bite off each other thinking they have to be a hardcore band. So we were trying to stay away from that for sure.
Yeah, I definitely see that. And whenever I come across the album art, I'm like, wow, this is like really interesting. And when I look at that, I wouldn't assume that it's a hardcore record. So I think it looks like pretty abstract, but I'm definitely into it. And I'm always like curious about it because it has like all the different, like, I guess it would be masks like on that brick wall, and then, you know, you look at the table, there's the what looks like a revolver, and then like the bottle about to fall off the table. It's pretty interesting. There's a lot going on there.
Yeah, it I don't know, man, something about just the way it looks, like it's not super perfect, so it's kind of like weird. It kind of makes me feel like weird staring at it. You see all these little things in it, and it's like, wow, that's kind of fucked up looking. It's funny too, because usually I don't check out a lot of stuff if the artwork's like really strange and they're like, they're trying to like show you they're a hardcore band, but they got this weird ass look to it. And to me, sometimes I'm like, oh, they're just trying to be like different too much, and it's going to be weird. So I'm like, damn, like we kind of did that. I'm surprised like people actually still checked it out, because I mean, that's just me. I'm hella weird like that, but I'm stoked on it.
Yeah, and just curious, you guys sold out of the vinyl. Any chance for another pressing?
I think we did 3 pressings of those.
Yes.
Honestly, I'm not sure. I mean, the dude over at Creator Destructor kind of just been doing his own thing, which is fine, but I think we're on the 3rd one already. But I don't know. We don't personally have any plans for anything like repress for that one. Not yet, at least.
Okay. I noticed that you guys credit Alex Herrera for designing your guys' logo, which I think is super awesome.
Hell yeah.
When I look at that, I'm like, okay, I feel like the logo like perfectly like kind of encapsulates like what Gulch is.
Yeah, I mean, Alex fucking knows what he's doing 100%. So, I mean, all we got to do is tell him what we want, and, you know, he hits it first try. He's done so many logos for bands around the Bay and like all over. So obviously I'm going to hit him up. That's the homie for sure.
Yeah. Cause I sometimes like when I look at like metal fonts, sometimes it gets like a little too crazy and I'm just like, I don't even know what that says. But when I look at the Gulch one, just like with like the lettering and just with the spikes coming off, I just feel like that's just perfect. It's just like as simple and it's not too crazy, but you know, it just looks so awesome.
Yeah, we for sure told them to, you know, not do it super death metal because we're not a death metal band, but I mean, he could do it all. So, you know, as long as we're like Yeah, don't make us look like it doesn't open. You can do it, no problem.
Okay. There's a track on Burning Desire to Draw Last Breath, EPTS. Can you talk about what that song means?
It's really just, I don't know, a lot of the songs I write are super personal, but I write in a way that it's not blatantly like, oh, like me, this song's about me, this song's about, you know, whatever. EPTS just stands for Ever Present Thoughts of Suicide. I feel like it's pretty straightforward when you think about it that way, is like people who are that way and who have, you know, suicidal tendencies and shit, it's like it doesn't just go away. It's kind of always there. So, I mean, ever present, just kind of wanted to be blunt with it without putting it 100% in the name. And it's a long ass name that way anyway. So it's really just about that kind of shit, you know, and people's, you know, mental struggles with suicide and depression and shit. It just kind of runs rampant in my family. And, you know, I mean, you could fucking name 10 of your homies and probably half of them have those kind of thoughts as well. So it's just kind of like a sad reality. Yeah, that I like writing about.
And do you still deal with that stuff today?
Oh yeah. Yeah. That, I mean, that shit never goes away. It's just kind of how you deal with it. I mean, I'm at a good job, you know, I got my, you know, living space where I want it. Having that little shit like that helps, but, you know, just got to deal with it day by day.
Yeah, and I guess it was kind of appreciate, like, these small victories, just kind of try to, like, always reassess and try to keep moving forward and keep things positive.
Oh, yeah, it's all about the little things. At least for me, like, that's how I look at it. So it's like, you know, people have, you know, big goals they try to reach or whatever. But I mean, I've tried all kinds of bullshit and it's, nothing's really helped. I think as I gotten older, it's kind of become less, you know, in my face every day because I have a lot of responsibilities. I have shit I got to take care of. So I kind of have to focus on moving forward and not kind of getting stuck with that kind of shit. So it's like me sitting in my chair by the window, fucking, you know, just looking out and chilling, eating my food, like, that kind of stuff just kind of brings me back down and makes me not have to think about all kinds of different shit. So it's weird like that, you know, just getting out, getting sun and trying not to just be stuck in a dark room all day too, for sure helps.
Obviously we're still going through the pandemic. How are things going on up there where you're at?
It's been chill, honestly. I mean, right when it hit, I was looking for work back in San Jose with, like, my old boss. And he had some stuff for me, so it was cool. I got to work for a few weeks because my job out here got shut down, like, immediately. Then, you know, I was still locked up for a little bit and doing push-ups and watching TV and taking walks and cleaning my room, just, like, being super on top of that kind of stuff. So it kind of got to me for a little bit, but I made the most of it.
And are things, like, opening back up out in your area? Because down here, where I'm at in Orange County, things are slowly progressing towards opening up. Like, there's actual restaurants now where you can go dine in. But obviously, there's, like, you know, safety measures that the restaurants have to take. Like, my buddy and I went out to this Korean spot last weekend, and we got, like, temperature checked. They had, like, this device, like, in the lobby where they had us, like, stand in front of, and it, you know, checked our temperature and, you know, told us that we were good to go, which was, like, pretty interesting. I'd never done anything like that before, especially in a restaurant. So I'm just curious how things are in your area.
I haven't seen that yet, but I mean, at this point I'm cool off just getting takeout anyways, bringing it home and hanging out and eating, but I have to do that for my job. Every morning we take our temperature, we fill out a paper, you know, do you have any symptoms? No. Do you have a headache? No. Blah, blah, blah. Do you have your proper PPE for work, your mask? Like, are you willing to follow safety protocols? And you have to sign it. Can't share tools. Gotta obviously still stay 6 feet away. If you break any of the rules, they can send you home, like, immediately. So it's kind of strict, but it makes sense. So at least we're working. But other than that, I mean, Target and stuff's been open, but you still gotta line up out the door and wear masks and all that stuff. But it's not too bad. I mean, I don't let it bother me. I'm not tripping on it.
I'm just curious, how does your work check your temperature?
We had, it's this weird one that you rub across your forehead, and they just sanitize it between each person that uses it.
And has anybody at your work, tested positive, or do you know anybody who's tested positive for COVID-19?
Nah, I don't know anyone personally. A bunch of my friends, though, they like have guys at their work who have like tested positive for it. They shut down for a couple days and get everybody back in, and you know, make sure everything's sanitized. But I haven't had any personal people that I know test for it.
Yeah, same here. And I, to my knowledge, I don't have it, but I'm curious to know if I've had it and I just didn't know, because you know, there's like that antibody test where it'll be able to tell you that or be able to check if you've had it or not.
I think I for sure had it at FYA, honestly. I mean, hella fools I know had the same ass symptoms. I mean, my mom was tripping. She was like super sick. And everybody's traveling like crazy, and that was right around the time when it was like actually coming to the States, apparently, based on, you know, whatever the World Health Organization says. So, I mean, for all I know, I've had it, but yeah, I get sick pretty easily anyways.
Yeah, it is pretty interesting when people kind of look back and think about the end of last year and early this year, and people remembering how sick they were, and nobody really realized what it was. Even at FYA, I had a buddy that I went with, and he got put in the hospital like the night after the first night of FYA. We had to take him to the hospital like in the middle of the night. And now looking back, his because like he had some like some weird like blood disorder like pop up, and like he almost died. And he's been seeing these like doctors to like monitor his blood to make sure that it doesn't like pop up again. And they were trying to figure out like what caused it. And just recently, they're thinking that maybe he had COVID-19 back in January, and his body was just trying to fight it off, and that's why back then they couldn't figure out what was wrong with him.
That makes sense. I mean, that's exactly what I was thinking. You know, it's new. People don't know what it is. Young people who can find it off, get over it, and then just move on. You know, I mean, I've never had to go in to the doctor for any time I've really been sick, because I just kind of wait it out. You know.
Yeah, same here. Like I rarely get sick, but when I do, I just kind of just sit at home and just hope to get better. So I definitely understand, like, you know, that point.
Yeah,
but yeah. I had no idea you were sick during FYA. You were sick during the fest?
No, I got sick after. Because my girl got it really bad the last day, mm-hmm. And then by the time I got home, I was like, "Yeah, I don't feel good either." She was still a little sick, and I know some of the other guys got really sick too. Like pretty much everybody we were around at some point got sick when they got back.
That's crazy. It's only a trip to think back about that. But I was actually curious about your guys' time at FYA, because I know there was like a lot of crazy events. Like your guys' set was awesome. I actually just watched that footage like recently, and then there's like the whole hoodie situation. So can you talk about what your experience was like at FYA?
FYA was sick, man. That was our first time. That was my first time going, and obviously first time playing. I don't know, man. Florida's cool. We were just kicking it around, getting hella vegan food and saw the water. Had a cool little Airbnb. There was like chickens everywhere. Because we stayed in Ybor, and I guess it's like a thing out there. There's chickens all over the damn place. But yeah, we got to see a lot of cool people, a lot of cool bands. The set was cool. It was a good old time. Like, we had a good reaction. I was pretty surprised because first time being out that way. But I think that was when it really hit that, like, you know, people fuck with us. Like, seeing it in person, I was like, oh, damn, like, this is crazy. Like, we're in Florida, and there's actually people watching us. And then, yeah, the whole hoodie thing was wild, man. I was not expecting that. Me, personally, I'm not, like, a big merch guy. So when people drop, like, you know, new shirts, I'm like, oh, yeah, cool. Like, but it's not, like, my thing. So seeing people like kind of freak out over something of ours like was kind of weird, especially since a girl out here made this like random design for us, not even intended for like, you know, a piece of merch. And we ended up just being like, hey, like, can we actually use this? We'll just throw it on a hoodie. And we're like, you know, whatever. didn't think much of it, and then it just kind of blew up, and you know, a bunch of young girls ambushed us at the airport, you know, asking if they could buy it, like right when we landed. And you know, next thing you know, it's like people are just lining up the second we get there, and I don't know, it kind of threw me off. I wasn't expecting it, and you know, not my thing.
You know, I saw it get posted, and a lot of people reacting on Twitter, and I follow Cole, and I saw that he posted your guys's which terminal you guys were landing in and at what time, and I thought he was just trolling. I thought he was just, you know, being like, all right, cool, I'm gonna put this out there, and I didn't think anybody actually showed up. But I remember like earlier in the day, the day you guys played, I actually ran into Cole, and I talked to him because I was just curious. I was like, hey, like, you know, how many hoodies do you guys have? And he told me, he's like, dude, he's like, people came to the airport and bought some from us, and like we had to stop selling them because we needed to save some for the fest. He's like, yeah, he's like, honestly, we don't have a lot. And I was like, damn, that's fucking crazy that people actually showed up to the airport. Like, they took, you know, like the information that he posted on Twitter, and they're like, all right, cool. Like, we want this hoodie that bad that we're going to go to the airport. And I'm pretty sure you guys landed like around, like, it was like 10 p.m. if I remember correctly. Like, it was like later in the evening.
I can't remember. I think it was still light out, honestly.
Okay.
But still, like, yeah, I was just not expecting. I didn't even think when Cole posted it, I thought it was fake. Like, I didn't realize it was our actual itinerary.
Uh-huh.
So then when it happened, I was like, oh, no, wonderful. Like, because you posted that shit. Like, but yeah, I didn't think anybody would pull up. But I mean, you know, props to them. You know, they got theirs. This shit's crazy.
Yeah, like they got theirs at the airport, and they didn't have to, you know, stand in that huge line. Because I had friends that, you know, couldn't make it to the fest, and some people texted me like, hey, is there any way you can pick me up the Gulch hoodie? And I was like, sure. I was like, I'll try, see what happens. And I remember watching your guys' set, and I remember turning around because I knew where you guys set up your merch. So I remember turning around. Yeah. And I saw how long the line was. I was like, okay, there's no way I'm getting that hoodie based off like the info that Cole gave me on how many you guys actually had left and versus how many people I saw online. So I was like, yeah, I was like, I'm not even gonna even try. And I was like, you know, tripping out at how long it was, and then like caring about how people were waiting, like, you know, even before you guys even played your set. I was like, damn, that's so crazy that people like wanted that hoodie that bad.
I think we only made, Cole's probably going to be mad I even said this, I think we only made like 30 for the, because we didn't think anybody wanted them.
Mm-hmm.
Until it was like too late. Like, we printed them and people started tripping, and we were like, fuck, like we only made like a small amount and we have to leave. Like, we can't make any, well, we couldn't even fit anymore on the plane, and it was too late to ship them. Mm-hmm. You know, we just weren't ready for that kind of like hype over a sweater. So we're like, damn, like, well, whoever gets it gets it. I mean, we'll print more late, because we're not like that thing, we're like, oh, this is expensive, we're just gonna put out like a little bit and everybody is screwed, like, haha, you know, like, if fools really want it down. Yeah, I mean, we reprinted hell of those hoodies, so I mean, at this point, it's not like a rare item, you know, people want it, fine, like, you know, we'll make more, but at this point, we're done with it. You know, I'm tired of looking at the thing.
Yeah.
You know, I know people are like hating on it and hating on fools who have it, but man, whatever. Like, they like the hoodie, they got the hoodie, leave them alone. But I just thought that shit was crazy.
Yeah, because you got to think, we're in Florida, it's January, it's not that cold, and like we're about to hit, you know, like we're about to, like, winter's about to end, so like, you know, the market for hoodies, like, you know, isn't, like, shouldn't be that popular. But the fact that it was like insane, I thought it was like pretty cool. And I actually did appreciate the fact that you guys were like, all right, cool, we sold out, like, there's still demand for it, we're gonna just you know, leave it open for you, because like, obviously you guys, like, you know, reopened it, sold out like again, and you're like, all right, fuck it, like, we're just gonna open order, you guys just, everybody who wants to just order it, and then we'll make them, and then boom, that's it, like end of story. Like, I thought that was really cool of you guys to want to meet the demand for the hoodie.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like I said, I don't want to be that band that's just like trying to be super mysterious and, like, you know, exclusive. I mean, I was telling people in line at FYA, I was like, yo, we're gonna print more, like, you're for sure not gonna get one, you wait in the back of the line, like, honestly, just like, don't stand in line, like, we'll make more and you can get it online. And they still stood there, and I felt bad because, you know, it was other bands playing, I think only one other band was playing while they were in line, and then they were in line for us, like, while we were playing as well. And I thought that was a little weird, but you know, not my thing. I don't know shit about waiting in line for merch. So, I mean, if that's what people do, then that's what people do. But I don't know. I think it's kind of goofy, honestly.
Yeah, I think the last time I remember, like, waiting in line for merch was, it was like, I want to say, like, Sound and Fury 2010, maybe? It was, like, at the time, the Rival Mob. Like, people were, like, flipping Rival Mob t-shirts on, like, eBay for, like, $80. And
Jesus.
Yeah, which was, like, weird. And the band was like, okay, that's really weird. So we're going to limit, like, one shirt per customer. So, like, people had, you know, got in line and were only able to buy, like, one shirt and, you know, kept it moving. So I'm pretty sure that was, like, the last time I like, camped out for, like, a piece of merch.
Yeah, I know Rival Mob was... people were buying this shit like crazy. Like, I remember seeing it come and go and then just be posted up on eBay like the next day for hella expensive. And I was like, dude, like, what? Like, same with Boston Strangler. If you like, at least for like vinyl and shit, like a lot of their tapes and stuff went for a lot of money. Like, cause they didn't make a whole hell of a lot of them. Like, not the early stuff, that's for sure.
Yeah. You know, I found it pretty interesting that you mentioned that. You kind of like, or kind of hit you at FYA that, you know, people kind of you know, fucked with Gulch, because I thought like the turning point for you guys was when you released the promo in 2019, because I felt like like the day that came out, it was everywhere, like all over Instagram, Twitter. Like I actually you know, listened to it like the first day it came out, and I was like, oh, this is insane. And I felt like that was the turning point in my eyes for you guys, because, like, you know, like the promo came out, and then you guys did that run. It was Drain, Hands of God, and Gulch. You guys you guys all went and played that. It was that tour. I can't remember all the dates, but I remember you guys played Louisville. You guys played I'm not sure. I can't remember if it was the This Is Hardcore was a part of that same run.
No, we played This Is Hardcore before the tour, and then we told, yeah, you know what, maybe it was really This Is Hardcore where it was like, okay, like, damn, this is crazy. And then the tour was like, all the shows were really surprisingly good, and then I guess that's when it kind of hit me then. And, you know, just to keep that momentum into January, I was like, okay, like, you know, we're doing something right.
But, yeah,
dude,
yeah.
All our shows on that tour were really sick. I mean, Hands of God and Drain 2 had like insane reactions. It was just super sick.
There was that video from the Louisville show where when you guys started playing, everybody busted out those belts and started hitting you. Was there like some sort of like backstory behind that on why they did that, or was that just like, you know, some thing you guys did for fun?
Well, so I don't remember what show it was where I started doing that. I think it was one of Santa Cruz, honestly. I just randomly took my belt off and started hitting fools with it, including, like, you know, Cole and Christian. And, you know, I would just kind of, like, punch Christian or kick the hell out of him randomly just because it was funny. Mm-hmm. And so I think it kind of just stemmed from that. And so on tour, I kept doing the same shit, you know, whipping the belt out at some point and just smacking everybody on stage with it. And so they plotted against me last day of the tour. I had no idea they were going to do that. So I just kind of saw them all standing around. I thought nothing of it. Next thing I know, I'm getting jumped.
That's so crazy.
But that's what I get, honestly.
Yeah, no, it was like definitely like, you know, pretty interesting, you know, to see. But look, it was all in good fun. You guys were having a good time. That show looked awesome.
Hell yeah. The show was crazy.
Okay.
It's actually funny. I love the story. I always forget to like talk about it with people, but this dude came up to me before the set and was like, hey, man, like, I want you to, like, hurt me during the set. And I was like, what? I was like, all right, what? Okay. So, I don't know, man, just, like, hit me. Because, I mean, at that point, people kind of saw that we did that already. Mm-hmm. I was like, all right, like, whatever. And after I get jumped by everybody with the belt, one of the homies, like, left his on the floor right in front of me, and I just grab it and I just throw it. Just randomly throw it. I didn't even look. And I guess, like, later he came up to me, and his face was all cut up. He's like, man, you hit me with the belt. Like, hell yeah. And I was like, what? What the fuck you mean? And I ended up seeing a video, and you could see the belt flying and hitting that dude specifically right in his face. And he was just, like, super stoked about it. And I thought that shit was just crazy. I was like, damn, like, what luck. You know, I just happened to hit that fool who asked me to hit him with a random belt.
Yeah, because that definitely, I feel like, is a strange request, like, especially like right before your set, and like, hey, well, I want you to hurt me. But at least you didn't have to do it like intentionally and like, you know, have it be weird. You kind of just, you know, it all just happened by chance.
Yeah, it's just a crazy, you know, twist of fate, I guess.
And so every time I've ever seen you guys always have your shirts off. I feel like that's a, you know, it's like a cool branding. Like I know, like when I see Gulch, it, you know, everybody's gonna have their shirts off. Is there a specific reason why you guys do that?
We did it randomly when we played in Fresno because it was stupid hot, because Fresno was always stupid hot.
True.
We were playing at CYC, and it just, you know, we just kind of were like, all right, it's hot, you know, and I'd take it off and someone else would, and then it just kind of happened. We were all, you know, shirtless on stage, and we never like meant to like make it a thing. I think someone like made a joke about it, and then the next time we're like, you know, we were playing and someone was like, why are you guys shirts on? You know, eventually it just kind of became a thing, like unintentionally. We were like, oh, whatever, let's just do it. And now it's just kind of habit, and it's stupid because I don't like gimmicks, but it's also funny because I don't really give a shit. Because it's like, whatever, but it's just funny that people expect that from us now, and it's kind of like, if we don't do it, it'd be weird.
Yeah, I
don't really get it, but
I feel it's like the only time I ever look forward to seeing guys with their shirts off is, I'm like, all right, cool, Gulch is playing, everybody's taking their shirts off. I'm like, all right, cool, everything seems right, like, let's get it going.
Yeah, I know, right? It's like, and then people in the crowd do it too, and it's just like, all right, cool, like, you know, people are weird and I fuck with it.
Okay, so you guys put out the promo, which was awesome. I like I said, I feel like that was the turning point. That came out July. Did you guys plan to just wait till the new year to try to put out the new record, or did you guys have plans that just you know, didn't come to fruition for 2019?
Well, so the promo, we kind of had like a different idea for the promo at first. We were going to do like those two songs and then maybe a live set that the homie and SJ recorded, like just the live audio on like a tape, you know, like the two promos and then the B side would be the live set. Not really planned to have like a full release yet, but then it just kind of like became this thing where Cole was still writing, he had some songs in the works already, and we were like, okay, maybe we should just drop these as a promo instead of just like a little, you know, side thing, and then work towards, you know, an LP. Because normally I don't like doing LPs, but it's still, you know, short and sweet enough for me to be like, okay, like, I'm down for it. No filler, and, you know, because I feel like when you do an LP, sometimes there's just bound to be filler tracks and stuff to like pad out that time, you know, you got to make it an LP. But yeah, I mean, we just kind of shopped around and had ideas on if we wanted to have somebody else put it out, and we ended up getting hit up by a closed casket, and we were like, all right, let's, you know, we'll do that. Got what we wanted, you know. We didn't have expectations to tour because we are all super busy, full-time working and everything. So as long as we were able to, you know, come to an agreement with Closed Casket, then we were down to put it out. So, and then once, you know, once you get put on with the label, it takes time for them to actually put it out because, you know, they take it to a specific plant and you got to get the artwork approved and the mastering. And so just kind of, you know, when we do shit ourselves, it's obviously going to come out quicker, but, you know, it's not up to us at this point, but I'm not really stressed on it. It's kind of good we waited anyways with all the shit that's going on in the world right now. It's kind of other things to focus on.
So that's one thing I wanted to touch on. You mentioned Closed Casket. Early January, you tweeted about Gulch being on Closed Casket. And I looked around, and I didn't see any like official announcement from Closed Casket. And then recently, one of your guitar players was auctioning off a test press of the new record, Impenetrable Cerebral Fortress. And one of the pictures shows Closed Casket activities. So I'm, you know, obviously it's official, you're saying it on here, but have they just, you know, been keeping, you know, things quiet until they can actually have like an official release with the actual record?
They made a post on Instagram. Okay. It was like the mask that we always have on our artwork. with the closed casket logo around it, like the bullets. And then that's kind of like how we just announced it, but it wasn't anything crazy where we did like a big, you know, promo shot and all this stuff, because I mean, we just like to keep it low key anyways. And it's funny that you mentioned the auction, because that fool wasn't even supposed to talk about the album name yet. Nobody knew it. And we'll just like name drops it, which is fine, like whatever. But the dude from Close Casket wasn't really tripping. But so it's funny that you mentioned that, because yeah, that wasn't really supposed to be known yet. But I mean, we're just keeping it all low key until the record's actually out. That way, it's not like, you know, you get overhyped stuff sometimes, and it's just kind of like a little weird when it comes out and falls short. And I just never want to be that band. So when it comes out, it comes out, and you know, people can just have it right away.
And so I'm just curious, can you talk about how many tracks are on the record, or do you have to keep that stuff like private still?
Nah, whatever. It's I think there's 8, so 7 and a cover.
Oh,
which okay. I say, but yeah, a cover's on there, which is cool.
That's awesome. And is like the artwork and everything finalized?
Yeah, we have the artwork. We actually had the artwork like over a year ago. Like the dude made it like immediately.
Oh wow!
When we hit him up and told him that we were even planning on doing another record, and he just had it right away. So we just been sitting on it.
Did you go back to Boone?
Same guy. Yeah, we had to.
Oh wow, dude. Sure. Okay, that's exciting. I'm actually really excited to hear that, because I was really curious if you were going to go back to him, because obviously you had you know, just like a layout for the promo, which was that done by Kat, if I remember correctly?
Yeah, she did that, which was really cool.
Okay, yeah, so I wasn't sure if you were going to go back to like you know, like a legit album art for the record, or if you're going to do something simple, but okay, that's really awesome to hear that you guys went back to him. That's so sick, okay.
Yeah, I mean, he's, you know, he did us well the first time, and it was like super cool, he's a great guy, so, you know, might as well. I mean, we do like supporting like the homies around here. That's why we had Kat do the promo art and stuff. And you know, we get a lot of our designs from like homies around here. And if Cole doesn't do the stuff himself, so
okay.
But it is cool to go back to Boone. He's a good guy.
Yeah, hell yeah. I'm seriously like I'm stoked to hear that. But going back to the auction, I thought that was awesome that your guitar player auctioned off that test press, because I saw like so many bands coming together and just trying to do what they can to help out with what's going on. So I thought that was really awesome of him, because like obviously like the record's not out and people like love test presses, like that's like, you know, stuff are like highly sought after. So the fact that he was willing to do that on something that's not even out yet, I thought that's like really cool of him to do that.
It's good to see, man. Like the fact that all these bands are doing what they're doing, you know, trying to make money for a good cause. It's like, you know, it's exactly what this shit is about, you know. Like, schools want to preach this and that and talk about it in songs and whatever and take a hard stance, you know, behind like a internet, you know, like a fucking computer screen. So to see it actually happening in real life and fools out there, you know, doing their part and raising money and, you know, physical help is what we need. So it the hardcore community doing that is, yeah, it's what it's all about, you know what I mean?
Yeah, because you gotta think about we're all kind of in the same boat where with this whole situation with no shows going on, which is insane, because you gotta think about there's never really been a time where we're all kind of experiencing like the same thing at the same time. So the fact that you know, there was no shows and we're all just dying to get to a gig, to see a band, like whatever band it is, but then you know, these protests happening and seeing the scene come together again and being like, for the majority like everybody that I'm like a fan of or people that I'm friends with, we're all kind of on the same side and everybody coming together and just like raising so much like awareness and even like, you know, just raising all the amounts of money, which is insane. And it was just cool even to see like, you know, bands that aren't even like super active anymore like coming out and just trying to do their part and just kind of use like whatever platform they have just to try to, you know, just do it for a good cause. I thought it was just like really awesome and just like really cool to see us like, you know, be able to come together and just like kind of just do our part and, you know, speak and, you know, do what we always like, you know, like want to support.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody has a platform, and you know, as long as you use it the right way, you know, you get the message out across. I mean, a lot of people probably feel feel obligated at this point too. Like, you know, if you're not doing it and using your platform for the right reasons, then, you know, what the hell are you doing? Is it for personal gain? Like, are you just here to make a name for yourself, make money and fill your pockets in a dip? Or, you know, that's how I like to look at it. So as long as everybody's doing what they, you know, preach, then, you know, we're all here for the same reasons.
Yeah. And I try not to get too caught up, you know, in trying to call people out on, you know, being fake about it. I just, you know, want to just try to focus on the positive and, you know, try to make the change. And then maybe we can go back and try to call out the people who are being fake about it.
Yeah. As long as you do your part and you know that, you know, for me, it's like, I know I do what I do and what other people are out there, you know, faking and front and shit. It's like, that's their business. Mm-hmm. And it'll come back to them eventually. Everybody's going to see that fool who's out there just doing the shit to make himself look cool, but he really ain't doing anything. People see that, you know, a fraud is easy to spot. So, I mean, someone else is going to call that fool out anyways, but I'm just focusing on me and doing my part, and the people in my circle, making sure we're all doing what we need to do, and everybody else is going to get theirs in the end. So,
yeah, for sure. I definitely feel the same way. Like, there, like, people, like, you know, talking about how it's, like, you know, corny to go and take, like, a selfie at the protest. And I'm just like, okay, cool. I was like, I'm glad that's a thing, because to go and just kind of show off that you're there, but, like, taking a selfie, I think is just really corny. So I'm glad people were, you know, talking about that. And that's just one thing that I, like, you know, feels, like, really corny. So I want to see less of that.
I just think it's, like, dangerous too. You know what I mean? It's like, you're putting your face out there to people who are very much against the movement. Mm-hmm. And if they really want to do something to you, they already know exactly what you look like, and they know what you're wearing of these things and where you're at and how often you're going. I mean, it's so easy to just open up Instagram, watch someone's story, be like, oh, he's there right now, you know, and I'm going to pull up and I'm going to catch him out there. You know, it really takes no time at all to catch somebody something like that. So, you know, posting shit after you've left is definitely how you should be doing it. You know, once you're home, you could post videos and stuff, but I mean, at the end of the day, you don't want fools' faces on it. It's not very smart. And if you're doing it for clout, it's like, all right, you know, we see you out there just taking pics and leaving. It's not cool at all.
Yeah, because there's that famous video of that reporter who ended up losing her job, where she, like, went and, like, asked, like, some guy. She's like, hey, can I hold your drill and make it look like I'm, like, helping you board up this shop? But it was all being filmed, and she literally just took the photo, handed the guy his drill back, and then just kind of, like, trotted off.
Oh, she lost her job over that?
Yeah, yeah. I was reading reports that she was, like, she was some reporter, and it went so viral. So many people saw that. People found out who she was, and, yeah, they're like, wow, like, that's so fake and so wrong. Like, see ya.
I thought it was just some random, like, you know, Instagram celebrity or some bullshit, but that's pretty funny.
Yeah.
People are so stupid.
Yeah, it's definitely wild, but yeah, it's definitely definitely an interesting time in our history, and I'm, like, really hoping for positive change. So I'm just, you know, just kind of trying to follow the news that I get from social media. That's where I get all my news, is from Twitter, because I feel like it just comes so fast, and obviously, like, I don't take every single tweet as, like, you know, the truth. I always try to dig a little deeper to find out what actually is true, but I'm just hoping, you know, in the end, there's positive change, and, you know, we can kind of restructure this whole, like, corrupt thing going on.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's one step at a time. I mean, this shit has been a long time coming. It's just now more people are seeing it. I feel like the internet has really made it so easy for people to access information that once something like that happens, like George Floyd, everybody sees it, and everybody is just immediately like, boom, like, we're gonna do this, we're gonna protest out here. And then, you know, you don't even have to see the shit on TV before you know what's going on. Like, it's, you got people who are there and you trust, and you see them post stuff, and that's mainly where I get it from. It's either being there or people I know that I trust being there and posting about it, like, what's actually going on. That's, you know, eyewitness is definitely the most true account of what's actually happening in this world, because if you don't see it, it's easy to fake it.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. Like, if that girl didn't film that video of what happened to George Floyd, like, you know, that would have just probably got swept under the rug and we wouldn't be out here trying to make change today.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it was going to be, okay, who's next to die before people actually, you know, get sick of this shit again, you know? It's just, it's sad, but that's how it is, you know?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Just want to switch gears and bring it back to Gulch. I seriously can't remember. I don't know, my memory's so bad, but you guys were scheduled to headline a show in Texas. Can you talk about how that came about?
Oh, sorry. What was the question at the end there?
I couldn't hear you. Can you talk about how that whole thing came together?
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure. Someone hit up, I think it was Cole or Sammy. I don't know. I don't deal with a lot of the booking because I have a horrible memory and I forget and I get asked things and I never ask anybody because I just honestly just have the worst memory. So if I get hit up for anything, just FYI for anybody listening, that's, you know, don't hit me up because I will forget. I don't know. The guy booking it just kind of reached out and was like, hey, I'm doing this fest weekend in Texas. You know, I know it's like a Wednesday, Thursday or Thursday, Friday, but you know, I'm sick of you guys come out. You will get another show going, that Thrasher thing. And then, you know, you can make a weekend out of it. So we're like, all right, you know, and then we got hit up to do a show under some bridge out in Austin that I guess No Warnings played before. And it was going to be like two shows in one night. So we were super stoked. And then obviously this coronavirus killed all our plans for the year. But that Texas thing would have been fun for sure because we haven't been out there. But I mean, we were supposed to play with like Mortifera and Fiddlehead and No Right was going up. There was a hell of bands playing. I honestly can't remember all.
Yeah, I feel like that would have been a good thing for you guys to get out to like a new market, and I'm sure there's kids out there dying to see you guys. So I'm sure it would have been cool for you guys to play in front of like a whole new audience.
Yeah, exactly. It's always fun just like playing a new spot, and I mean, I hella like Texas. There's a ton of good food over there, and you know, a lot of good bands out of Texas. My dad lives in Texas now, so
oh wow,
cool. It'd be cool to just get out there again.
You know, it's,
the weather sucks though because I hate the heat like that. Honestly,
yeah. Some friends and I actually did like a weekend trip to Texas. Like we drove from Southern California straight to Austin, and it was the first time that I'd ever gone to Texas, which was like kind of like a strange thing for me because you know you hear about Texas like your whole life growing up and then you finally get there and realize like how big that state actually is. It's such a trip.
It's huge. That's crazy. What did you guys do in Austin?
So we stayed in Austin but we drove out to Texas because the friends that I went with, they're like really into horror, so the house from the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre is out in like Kingsland, Texas, if I remember correctly, and we just drove out to go check it out because they like turned it into some like brunch spot, and like they obviously you know pay homage to the movie, so they just wanted to go check it out, and they hit me up, they're like, hey, you got any free time this weekend? I'm like, fuck it, let's go. So we went out there for that.
Hell yeah, that's sick.
Yeah, it was definitely insane. Just obviously being in a car for that long. I'm sure you know you've gone on tour, so you know what I'm talking about. But yeah, just those drives were just so long, and especially just going through Texas and it just being like so flat and just nothing around you for like the longest time. It's like, God, I want to get out of here so bad. And even like when we're driving home, it felt like we were in Texas forever. Like it felt like we were never gonna escape. It felt like we were just gonna be there forever.
Yeah, it's huge. It's bigger than California, I believe. Yeah, it's for sure bigger.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can fit Africa. Yeah,
I mean, and driving through California is crazy, too. That shit sucks. I hate it. I hate that drive to L.A., I'm not going to lie. 7 hours, 6 hours, for me, that's eternity. I'd rather die.
You know what's crazy? I've never been up north for a show.
Not for real?
Yeah, never. You know, it's crazy because, like, I'm, like, my early days of like, you know, getting into hardcore, like I listened to bands like, you know, like from your area, like Lose None, On a Warpath, Hoods, Trash Talk and stuff. But like, I just like, you know, at that time I was young, couldn't drive. And then even now, you're just getting into the bands, like, you know, that you're in and your friends are in, like, you guys make me want to go up to the Bay. And I said this on the last podcast I did with Joseph from Tsunami, and I some friends and I planned on actually going to that Drain show. So it's just like, damn it, like, I that was going to be like my first time up north for a show. But obviously, you know, this whole thing happened, show got you know, postponed or canceled, but I'm planning on getting up there at some point. Like, it, like, I feel like it has to happen, because, like, I feel like right now there's just so many good bands, you know, that are coming from out of there. Like, I have to, like, experience, like, what it's like up there.
Yeah, you should, for sure, honestly. I mean, I love the Bay, obviously. I'm gonna hype it up forever, but I mean, we have a lot of, you know, good people out here going off for all the bands. You know, I mean, even shows on, like, Monday nights are crazy. It's just, like, a good, small, local scene. Everybody's known each other for years. And, you know, all the new people that come in are welcomed with open arms at this point. You know, it used to be different back in the day. I mean, obviously, like, when I was young coming up, it wasn't, like, very friendly. So it's nice to, like, see everybody kind of coming up and just doing it for, you know, the music and not for everybody's own ego, so... That's why I love San Jose and, like, Bay Area shows. Everybody's just having a good old time.
Yeah, and that's what I've, like, kind of taken away with, you know, all the conversations that I've had with everybody from up in your area. Like, everybody's been, like, super, like I feel like super real to me, and, like, you know, just telling me, like, how it is, and, like, you know, friendly, and like, I've never thought anybody was, like, too cool from your area to talk to me. Even, like, when I reached out before I even had any relationships with anybody from up there, like, everybody was always cool to me, like, you know, from the jump. So, like, I've always, like, appreciated that about you guys up there.
Yeah, I think it's because it's, like, we don't have, we're not, like, a big, like, presence in hardcore like most places, like, you know, like New York hardcore, like, you know, Boston, LA, like all the big ones, they're famous, well known for all the bands that come out of there. And it's like San Jose has like bands and other things, like Sleep is obviously from San Jose, that's probably one of the biggest bands in like the harder scene. But, you know, we have always been more low-key. Like, the punk scene out here is hella crazy, but it's not guys looking to make a break. It's like fools who love being from San Jose and from like the Bay. So like staying here and just keeping it local is like what the goal is for the most part. Like, that's what, you know, I was down for. Like, oh, we'll just play local shows, we'll just do whatever here. And it just kind of happened that we got all this hype and that we got to travel. But like at the end of the day, I feel like that's why it's not a lot of cool guys that come out of like the Bay, because everybody's really like just about doing it for the city they're from, you know what I mean? Like, we have what we have here and we just enjoy it. So you don't got a lot of egos coming out.
So looking forward to the future, are you guys like going to be more open to doing more tours and traveling more with Gulch?
Hopefully. I mean, this year we had a lot of stuff lined up where we were traveling. Like, we had Damage City, we had the Texas stuff. What else did we have? Obviously, Sound of Fury, some other stuff that was supposed to come up. But so we were going to be around, but, I mean, the homie Cole has a kid and runs the print shop. Like, that's his full-time thing. Sammy's back down south working full time. I mean, pretty much everybody works and has like their own thing going, and plus Drain is moving so fast, so it's kind of hard for us to get out a lot. But I mean, if we can make it happen, we'll do it. But I mean, I'm super busy up here with work, and as long as I can get the time off, you know, I'm down for it.
Yeah, you mentioned those things that you had lined up, and I still trip out and think about how this year FYA has basically been like the only fest to actually happen here in the States.
Yeah, damn.
Yeah, and we're we're like halfway through the year, like 6 months. Like, there definitely should have been some other fests that should have already happened by now, but just like looking back and thinking like, holy shit, like being at FYA, I never thought that would be it for a long time, because obviously I the other day This Is Hardcore announced their dates. So you know, Joe's posted about how he has no intentions of canceling, he's gonna make it happen somehow. So I think that's awesome. So maybe you know, that will be the next fest that happens. But if for some weird reason it doesn't happen and no other fests like pop off for the rest of the year, and like we only had that one fest, like it's going to be like, oh, definitely like a strange year to look back on.
For real. I've never seen that in my years going to shows. So kind of sucks, man. I mean, even just having local stuff, like we don't have shit going on right now. And it's like, damn, you know, it's nice. I'm saving money, sitting around just working, but damn, I want to go to a show. That's where I see a lot of people that I don't see every day. You know, I've got my circle that I'll see outside of shows and, you know, to and from work or whatever. But, you know, there's a group of people that, you know, we're just, when we see each other at shows, it's like, we've, you know, nothing same. So it kind of sucks that hasn't been going on.
No, I definitely understand where you're coming from, because like I feel like during this whole thing, like outside of like seeing the people at work, like I've probably only seen like four or five friends like consistently, because I hang out with other people, but normally we go out and do stuff. But this whole time, there's really been nothing for us to go out and do, since everything's been closed. And obviously, people you know, have been kind of cautious about COVID, so people kind of wanted to just kind of stay away, which totally fine. I understand, get that, and I respect that. So yeah, it's only been like strange times not seeing like a variety of people.
Yeah, exactly. It's weird. Definitely strange times we're living in right now, but just kind of gotta rough it out and make do for now. Hopefully it all goes back to normal. I'm sure when everything goes back to normal, shows are going to crack off again, and you know, business as usual. So
yeah, I'm just curious to see how things will shake out, because obviously things got postponed, but I think it gets to a point where like some things just have to flat out get canceled, because there's going to be so many you know, bands playing in different areas, and like I don't think everybody's going to be able to kind of like you know, come together and like get like one big fest going. Maybe that's what This Is Hardcore is going to be. I don't know, but I'm curious, like when things do, like, you know, kind of like find out, like fully reopen, and then shows do start happening again, are you going to be like cautious, like maybe not going out to every show or wearing a mask at shows, or are you just gonna kind of just go back and just, you know, act as if like this whole thing never happened?
I mean, I have a lot of homies who work in like, you know, grocery stores and stuff, and I've been around them, and I'm back at work, so I'm kind of like at that point where I'm exposed enough to where, you know, I'm just not seeing like elderly people, so mm-hmm. I'm fine with it. But, you know, for me, going back to shows when it all opens up, I feel like everybody will kind of be already more conscious of being, you know, clean, maybe washing their hands a little bit more and not fucking mouth breathing all over each other. So that'll definitely help. But I mean, I'm not going to be worried about it, you know. I definitely changed my routine since this has happened, so I might not be going out as much anyways, because I enjoy my time at home now a lot more than I used to. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's definitely changed in the week. So
and did you move recently, or because I remember you posting, because like you got like a bunch of new furniture?
Yeah. I moved to SF right after FYA. Basically, January 1st was like my official move-in date, but okay, since we had all this shit planned for January for shows and stuff, all the traveling, and then I was working but still living in San Jose, so it was like an hour drive there and like 2 hours home, I wasn't really moving much shit in here very fast. So I had like, you know, a bed on the floor and my TV on the floor on top of my PlayStation, so it just looked sad and, you know, depressing. So over time I finally got new furniture, and so it's nice now. But yeah, that move was a pain in my ass. The commuting shit was horrible. So moving out here and being 10 minutes away from the job site versus an hour there and 2.5 hours home, mm-hmm. in traffic, definitely a big plus.
Damn, yeah, that's one thing. Like more recently, I kind of noticed that the freeways are like back to normal, which I used to enjoy just getting off work and getting home in like 10 minutes, but now it takes me a little longer to get home.
Yeah, luckily that doesn't affect me anymore. But when I was working in San Jose right when the quarantine hit, there was absolutely no traffic, so it was amazing. But yeah, my boss and his brother live in Oakland. So they got to go over the bridge. It's really only like normally a 20-minute drive, 25 from the job site. Takes them like an hour now, maybe an hour 30 if it's a really bad day, but it's getting back to normal for sure.
And is this the first time you've ever lived in SF?
Yeah.
Okay.
My girlfriend's born and raised SF, and I'm from SJ, so I got the opportunity to work in San Francisco for a hell of a lot more money. So I was like, yeah, I got to jump on that and just kind of tough it out with that commute for a bit and until I could find a spot.
Yeah, I'm sure it's all worth it now because, you know, you seem settled in. And like you said, the drive to work is like way shorter, which is like always awesome.
Hell yeah. Yeah, and I love San Francisco. I mean, all the people out here, like their businesses and stuff are really cool. So it's nice to just like support them. You know, just hang out in the neighborhood and everybody. I don't know. That's just the way I am. I was like that in San Jose too. I just like knowing who's who and, you know, putting money back into the community here instead of, you know, Whole Foods sucks. You know, I don't want to give them. There's some little markets and shit around my neighborhood that I'll frequent. They're all super cool. So it's nice to just kind of do my thing out here.
Yeah, I feel like that was like a newer thing for me. I grew up in like the Palm Springs area, and like for the majority of my life, I never really thought about local businesses until I actually moved to Orange County, and I, you know, made some friends, and they kind of like, you know, put me onto like cool local spots that I'd never heard of, and I just kind of like realized like, wow, like this is really cool to know that I have these awesome things in my community. So like, I feel like I like prefer going to the local stuff versus like the big chains when I can.
Oh yeah, for sure. It's definitely, I mean, my thing is to have this conversation last night with some homies, is a lot of people like to talk about gentrification all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, about basically everything is, oh, they gentrified this, gentrified that. And then, you know, I see what they're doing on, you know, their daily routine is they're going to some expensive-ass coffee shop chain, then shopping at, you know, Whole Foods, which, you know, whatever, and, you know, all this shit like that. And then I'm like, you know, you're not putting any money back into the actual community. Like, yeah, that Whole Foods is in your neighborhood, but that shit ain't owned by homeboy from the neighborhood. Like, that's, you know, that's some millionaire, billionaire who, you know, operates that shit. And, you know, really you're not giving back to the community. I mean, you're supporting workers, but, you know, the guy who owns a little shop around the corner, you know, is reliant on people who come in every day, coming in, you know, from that area. You know, nobody's traveling from other neighborhoods to go to, you know, a locally owned corner store. You know, they thrive off the people who live there. You know, so if you move into a neighborhood and you're new there and you're bouncing around other spots, putting your money everywhere else, you know, you're not actually supporting the community. And that's what gentrification does, pushes these guys out. You know, they're not making any more money and they got to move.
Yeah.
So you got to really look at yourself and see how much of a problem are you creating in the long run before you start, you know, waving the gentrification flag at everybody else.
Yeah, no, I definitely feel you on that one, because where I'm at, I actually live in Anaheim near Disneyland, so I'm like surrounded by the resort, and there's always like these awesome like hole in the wall places that I love going out to eat. That's like how I like when I go out to like these local spots, it's mainly like food places, because I just love eating out and just like trying to go out and find like the best like local spots.
Yeah. I mean, that's what people should be doing, you know what I mean? Like, if you're not cooking at home, like, go find the spot where the lady's been there for, you know, 25 years, just doing her own thing, and it's all, you know, hole-in-the-wall stuff, and, you know, you're supporting somebody who actually gives a shit. Like, the homie over here at this corner store around the corner from me, I mean, every time I go in there, the place is a mess, there's shit everywhere, it's just not, like, you know, it's not hella nice, it's not hella fancy. He's got everything you need, though, and the homie's hella nice. So, of course, I'm going to go back there, you know? Dude is always super appreciative anytime anybody goes in there and spends fucking a cent, you know? So, it's like, dudes from the neighborhood, you know, people who hang out there from the neighborhood, and they're giving him the support that he needs. And that's the only reason he's still there, you know what I mean? Because some fancy, you know, corner store could come in all nice and shit, jack up prices. They'll make money, but, you know, they're not from here. So
yeah,
you got to keep these people alive by supporting him.
Yeah, and he's literally there, you know, trying to provide a service to everybody that's, like, around him, you know, that's local, to try to make it convenient for them to just to pop in and, you know, pick up stuff that they actually need instead of having to drive, like, miles out to somewhere else and, you know, making it, like, a big old thing.
Yeah, exactly. It's little things like that that people don't really think about every day, which I get, you know. Yeah. Gentrification is more than just people moving into the high-rise building across the street from you and raising the rent. You know, it's a whole system in place that, you know, it's got to look at it from more than one perspective.
I find it interesting. You know, you mentioned you moved to SF, but it's like super expensive to live there because of you know, all the tech companies up there. Like, do you find that people are getting pushed out of the city?
Oh, hell yeah. SF is super expensive. I mean, so with San Jose, they're actually right next to each other. I think actually right now, SJ is higher rent, you know, than SF, but
okay.
I haven't checked in a while, but I used to pay like $1,500, $1,600 for a bedroom in San Jose. I got lucky here because it's like a homie and it's a big-ass house with hella roommates, so I don't pay nearly that much, but It does get crazy out here. A lot of people have had to relocate to like Oakland and like Antioch, Fremont, like all up and down the bay to spots that aren't, you know, as wanted. But it's crazy, man. The rent here is nuts. Shit has changed a lot, and I haven't even been to SF that much, you know, throughout my life. So it's crazy to even see the little things change right in front of me.
Yeah, I have a buddy who moved from San Diego to up there because he got a really nice corporate job with LinkedIn, which I think I can say that, but I won't give his name. But he got like this really nice job with LinkedIn, and I asked him, like, oh, like, are you gonna live in the city to be close to work? And he like straight up told me, he's like, dude, I can't afford to live in the city. It's just way too expensive. So he had to move like right outside the city, and I was like, damn, that's crazy that you're moving like literally to the other side of the state for this really nice job, but you still can't afford to, you know, live near your work. You have to, like, you know, drive out.
Yeah, it's that bad. I mean, you have to be making a lot of money for your own spot, or you just gotta find roommates. You gotta do, like, you know, a house in a neighborhood on the outskirts, you know. I mean, that's what I'm doing. I'm not, like, in the middle of the city. I'm definitely further south, like, maybe 5-10 minutes away from Daly City. So, it's, you know, it's kind of just what you got to do.
Yeah, no, I definitely feel you. Out here in Orange County, it's super expensive to just get any kind of place, just because it's, I feel like it's like centrally located, obviously. Like, where I'm at, I'm in Anaheim near Disneyland, so it's like super expensive because that park is, you know, super popular.
It's a tourist attraction for sure, yeah.
Yeah.
Damn, that sucks.
Yeah, but I get it. Just curious, have you ever been to Disneyland?
I have a few times. I like it, but I don't know. Not my thing. I know people go crazy about it and they're looking all the time. I'm just not a big like roller coaster or whatever guy, and I don't like being around a shitload of people. So that is two things that I don't really care for.
Okay, no, that's totally fair. I definitely get that. There's a lot of times where I get like antisocial. Like if I'm not, you know, at Disneyland or work, I'm seriously normally just home. I just like, you know, just going home and just hanging out. I have like really expensive like computer equipment that I like using because I spent so much money on it, and I like playing video games. So I'm like, all right, I'm gonna go home. There's, you know, things that I have to do online.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, everybody's got their thing, you know. Not everybody's super social like that. Like, it's nice to see the homies, but, dude, I can't be in a place like those thousands of people that I don't know and don't care about, you know, breathing all over me and just being in my way just freaks me out.
That's, yeah. But does it bother you when you're, you know, playing a show? Because obviously there's, like, so many people, like, you know, trying to jump on you, singing along, and you have to, like, you know, interact and touch a lot of people.
when I'm up there, I don't give a shit. But when I'm done, like, I like to just walk away and, you know, sit in a corner and just, like, chill for a second. But, I mean, at least with hardcore shows, it's, like, people I know, people have similar interests and similar ideals, and it's, like, a little bit easier to be around a ton of people because it's, like, more relate, like, I can relate to people more. But mm-hmm. when it's a crowd of just, like, everybody, like, Disneyland or the mall or some stupid shit like that, it's, like, fuck, like, I don't know these people, I don't like these people, I don't, you know, I don't care to know these people. Mm-hmm. It's kind of fucked up, but it's, like, that's just how I get.
No, I definitely understand. Like, my friends like to always give me shit because they always want to, like, go out and, like, meet new people. I'm like, oh, I'm like, that's totally fine. You guys go out and do that. Let me know how it is, because I'm just that's not my thing. I'm not trying to be everybody's friend just because I, you know, I don't think everybody's a good person. So I'm saying, I love the friends that I have, and, you know, the relationships that I have with certain people, and I just don't want to go out, like, looking for new friends. Like, I just, like, kind of like to let that stuff kind of happen organically, because I think it's just weird. Like, hey, like, I want to go make new friends today. That's just kind of strange to me.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I got my circle, and there's, you know, people I want to meet. I'll meet them at some point, you know, and it's just bound to happen. Other than that, I'm like, you know, I don't need to actively search for new people.
Yeah, for sure. I definitely feel you on that one. But Elliot, this has seriously been an awesome time. I'm like happy. I'm really stoked that we were finally able to do this. But before we sign off, is there anything you want to shout out or plug?
Shit. Everybody from San Jose, 408 through Water, Santa Cruz, Bay Area, Yulu, Tsunami, Hands of God, fucking No Right, Urban Sprawl. Damn, there's hella bands. Shit, man. Anything that comes out of the Bay, check it out. The Homies and Lead Dreams. There's just so many good people out here. And, yeah, Creator Destructor and Closed Casket. And you for having me, man. I appreciate it, for real.
All right. Well, seriously, thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you guys for tuning in to another episode of the JMRK podcast. Always on top.